Hi everyone, and welcome to Sunday Online from Frinton Free Church. It's great to have you here with me. My name's Mark, and the regular watchers of Sunday Online will recognise I'm on my own. Sally's taking some study leave this week, so I'm afraid you're stuck with me, but we're going to have a really good time together. Shall we pray before we sing? And Father God, thank you that we can join together as your body, the church. And as we watch online now, thank you that we are joining with millions of other people who make up your church around the world. And although we're not physically together, thank you that that doesn't matter, because your word promises us that we are your body, the church. And as your body, we choose to worship you now, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Whatever our day is like, whatever our week is like, whatever life looks like for us at the moment, the good and the not so good, we choose to be worshippers of you and to bless your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together.
Bless God in the sanctuary, bless God in the fields of plenty, bless God in the top.
So as always, there's a few things that I'd love to draw your attention to today. And the first one is that on Easter Sunday, we're going to be having some baptisms here at the church at our 10 o'clock gathering. And maybe you're thinking about getting baptized and you've got some questions and you'd like to know more about it. Well, we've got a class, baptism class, on the 13th of March. Details are on the screen. Do get booked in, come along and discover more about what it means to be baptised. And also on Easter Sunday in the afternoon, we're going to be taking a group of us out in the town to share Jesus with people. Good friend of our church, Chris Duffer, is going to be with us on Easter Sunday. And if you know Chris, you'll know he's got a huge heart for sharing Jesus and that good news of Jesus with other people in creative ways. And so here's an invitation to come and join that team. It's risky. It's not always going to be easy sharing our faith in that way. But do you know what? My experience is that when we step out in faith in that way, God just really blesses us. And we've got this wonderful news about Jesus that we want to share with other people. We don't want to keep it to ourselves. So here's an invitation and maybe even a bit of a dare for you to join that team and sign up and come and share Jesus with people on Easter Sunday. And then just the final little advert is that during the Easter holidays that follow and run into the start of April, we're going to have a Lego day here at the church. Don't you love Lego? I know myself and my family, we love putting together different models. It's still one of the biggest toys around the world. And we've got a company coming in who are going to bring loads of Lego bricks and little challenges for us to do. And we're inviting people in our community to come and share that day with us. Really, it's for families with young children. So please be praying for that day, but also maybe, you know, come along, bring some of your family, bring some children with you, or give that invite to some of your neighbours, because it's going to be a great day just to get to know people in our community, to bless them and just to introduce them to what Jesus' church is all about. So that's the Lego day that's coming up in April.
Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Oh, take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, well, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life. In awe of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me. You will be with me. Here I am, God.
all to Jesus now, holding nothing back, holding nothing back. I surrender.
Let us pray now for our world and local community. Jesus, Prince of Peace, we bring to you the countries in our world who do not have peace. We speak the names of Gaza, Ukraine, Yemen and Iran, and we speak your peace over them. We pray, as we have so many times before, that you will bring some kind of comfort to these homes and families decimated by fighting, that you will speak into the hard hearts of leaders intent on destroying. Jesus, will you soften our hearts to these situations that sometimes feel so far away and move us into action? Help us not to forget the importance the Bible places on peace. Help us, Jesus, to remember those suffering in our world. Good, good Father, we are so thankful for the work of the groups and charities in this area. We are so thankful that we have the facilities to be a hub of hope for this town. We pray particularly for the Dementia Cafe, Oasis Renew, the Bereavement Group and Breast Cancer Support Group, for ACORN, the school that we help run and support. Thank you for the many volunteers running in these initiatives. We lift them up to you now. We pray for the continued work of these groups, that there will be further resource to keep them going. Father, will you be at the centre in all things, so that the essential healing taking place in these groups will carry on and multiply. We also pray for other local initiatives in our area, for the food banks, mental health charities and mentoring schemes. We pray that these will continue to be forces for good, affecting the change in the lives of many. Lord of Life, we thank you for the variety of people in our church family. We thank you for the newly born, young, middle-aged and elderly. We thank you that we can all come together in worship as one body, one family. Lord, we pray for the families in our church and community. We pray for those raising, parenting and supporting children. We pray for parents in the haze of raising children. We ask for patience in the chaos, joy in the mundane, and wisdom in difficult moments. We pray for those in children's and families' work and education. We pray for perseverance to see your kingdom come, and we pray for moments that reflect your glory. We give thanks, God, for our older generation. Thank you for the experience they bring to our church family, and for the years of life they have lived that many of us can learn from. We pray for any older people in our church and community who may feel lonely or despondent about life. God, will you help us to see them and to support them? God, will you meet them in the quiet moments of their days and fill them with your Holy Spirit? Will you gather people around them, giving them a community and a space for sharing and friendship? God of all comfort, we pray now for ourselves, for hearts that may be heavy, grief-stricken, anxious, or indeed joyful. We recognise the importance of leaning into you, no matter what stage or age we are in. We bring to you our successes this week, our moments of failure, those times we have loved well and those times we haven't. As we lean in, may your arms enfold us, may your love keep us, may your peace comfort us, may your joy fill us. Amen.
Our Savior ever true, oh Jesus, we to you.
So if you've been tuning in over recent weeks, you'll know we've been working our way through the New Testament and part of our 5x5x5 plan to read the New Testament in 2024. And we've got to the end of the book of Acts, and we're going to be digging into the very end of it, and we're also going to use another part of the Bible, one of Paul's letters to Timothy, to help us to understand what's going on in today's passage. But just to kind of set the scene a little bit, this is a map of really what we've been reading this week in from chapter 25 through to chapter 28 in the book of Acts. And in these chapters, Paul really makes his way from the right to the left of the map up there. In chapter 25 and 26 and 27, we find him in Caesarea, and he's put on trial by the Roman governors at the time, a man called Felix and then another man called Festus, and King Agrippa, who's part of the Herod family, gets involved as well. And he's falsely accused of different things. And Paul, at this point, as a Roman citizen, we read, he appeals to Caesar, he appeals to Rome, and says, as a Roman citizen, I want my right to be put on trial in Rome. And so they send him off on a ship to make that journey to Rome with a number, hundreds of other prisoners. And that's where that red wiggly line kind of kicks in, and you can see the route that Paul takes around Cyprus there and over to Crete, where we're told he docks at this place called Fair Haven. And then it's winter, so a storm kind of brews up. And Paul warns them. He says, we shouldn't go any further. Let's stay here for a while. They don't listen to him, and they make that journey across kind of the top of the Mediterranean and the Adriatic Sea. And they end up being shipwrecked. There's a huge storm that blows up, and they end up being shipwrecked in Malta, where they end up staying for 3 months. As their shipwreck, Paul's bitten by a snake and people think he's going to die. It's kind of a real messy journey. And eventually, after 3 months, they leave Malta and they make their way to Rome. And in these last chapters, really, kind of what we're seeing is all this suffering and all this opposition that happens to Paul during that time. All the kind of exciting stuff that's happened up to this point kind of grinds to a halt, and he's kind of bounced from one court to another. There's a plot to kill him at one point. He's imprisoned for years. He's shipwrecked, if you say. He's bitten by a snake. And if you get to the end of the book of Acts and you read all this, you think, oh, there's going to be a big ending. There's going to be a big climax. And Paul is maybe going to meet Caesar. There's a thought about that. And he's going to get to share Jesus with Caesar, which would be incredible. Or maybe hundreds, thousands of other people might come to faith. But it doesn't happen like that. It's kind of anticlimactic. In fact, these are the last two verses of the book of Acts. For 2 whole years, Paul stayed, that's in Rome, there in his own rented home. He's under house arrest. He welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God, taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. And that is it. It's kind of abrupt. There's no news about his trial. There's no news even about, did he die? It's just that. And actually, one of the things we'll look at today is it's kind of a perfect ending to Luke's account here in the book of Acts. And it fits with the whole of Paul's message, that really the attention isn't on him at the end. However, what we can kind of deduce and find out from these two verses is that Paul, at this point anyway, probably didn't go on trial. You see, under Roman law, if you were accused of something, there was this period of 2 years where you were kind of put under house arrest. And during those 2 years, anybody, any of your accusers could come and bring their evidence. But the fact that Luke writes here that after 2 years, Paul is still in the same house, in the same place, doesn't mention a trial, probably means at this point there was no trial. But history tells us, tradition tells us, that sometime later Paul was rearrested in Rome, that he was put on trial, and that he was executed in Rome. And during that second imprisonment in Rome, Paul started to correspond with Timothy, one of his students who we've met earlier in Acts. And it's in these letters to Timothy that we get a glimpse of the end of Paul's life and what the end was like for him, more than just these two verses. So what we're going to do is we're going to read part of one of those letters, Paul's very final words that we ever hear him write in the Bible. And we're going to look at those, we're going to look at these verses, these two verses in Acts, and we're going to look at what it means for Paul's life to end. What does it mean for him to finish well? Did he finish strongly? So if you've got your Bible there, I'd love you to grab it and look up 2 Timothy 4, verses 6 to 22. Maybe you need to pause and look that up, but I'm going to read it to us now. This is what it says in 2 Timothy 4, 6 to 22. These are Paul's final words in the Bible. "For I am already being poured out like a drink offering. The time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I've kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day. Not only me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Do your best to come to me quickly. For Demas, because he loved this world, has deserted me and has gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia and Titus to Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, because he is helpful to me in my ministry. I send Tychicus and Ephesus. When you come back, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus in Troas and my scrolls, especially the parchments. Alexander the metal worker did me a great deal of harm. The Lord will repay him for what he has done. You too should be on your guard against him, because he strongly opposed our message. In my first defence, no one came to my support, but everyone deserted me. May it not be held against them. But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. And I was delivered from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory for ever and ever. Amen. Greet Priscilla and Aquila and the household of Onesimus. Erastus stayed in Corinth, and I left Trometheus ill in Miletus. Do your best to get here before winter. Eubulus greets you. And so do Pudens, Linus and Claudia, and all the brothers and sisters. The Lord be with your spirit. Grace be with you all." So apart from there being some tricky names for us to navigate in that passage, there is so much. And there's what we find in this passage is there's four particular perspectives that Paul holds on to that help him to finish well. So we're going to look at those, and say we're going to look at those verses in Acts 28, and we're going to ask ourselves the question today: how can I finish well like Paul? How can we, as we live our lives, how can we make sure that we finish well? What can we learn from Paul? And the first thing that we can find in this passage is that to finish well, I need to realise that life is a struggle. I need to realise that life is a struggle. Now, this is what Paul says in those verses, in that letter to Timothy. He says this: "I fought the good fight. I have finished the race." Now, the word that Paul uses here for fight is the Greek word agonismo. It's a great word, isn't it? Agonismo. It's where we get our word agony from. And it's a word that they also used for wrestling and for struggling against something. So Paul here is saying that he's fought the good fight, but he's struggled in the good fight. Up in the Lake District, in a place near Ambleside, there you find the Kirkstone Pass. And in the Kirkstone Pass, there is a road there, and it is called The Struggle. In fact, you can see, if you go there, you can see road signs and it's signposted, and it's called The Struggle. And the reason that it's called The Struggle, you can see a bit of it there, is that it is so steep. It is incredibly steep. I looked up online. Here's what somebody writes about it. It says this: the Kirkstone Pass is the highest major road in the Lake District. It reaches a height of 454 metres, and there are great views of the surrounding lakes. There's three different routes to the top of the Kirkstone Pass. The hardest is The Struggle, which takes the shortest route from Ambleside to Kirkstone Pass. It's the shortest in distance, but the steepest, and it requires over 400 metres of climbing. It is a struggle. It is winding. It is steep. If you want a different view of it, a graphical view of it, there it is. You can see just how steep it is. And there's a sense that as you're going up it, if you don't struggle, you're going to slip back down. You'll never make it to the top. I'd love to see a video of people when it's maybe icy and snowy trying to walk up The Struggle. I think if they'll just be slipping all the way back down to the bottom. And this idea of life being a struggle is something that Paul develops all through his writings. In 1 Corinthians 9, he talks about life as a Christian, as a disciple, being a struggle. And he likens it to being like an athlete or a runner, that you've got to train if you're going to get through it. Now, when we hear Paul describing life as a struggle, it's not what we might first think that he means by that. You know, he's not saying, you know, life is hard and woe is me. You know, he's not sort of quoting that famous fridge magnet that some people have that says, you know, life is hard and then you die. You know, it's all just miserable and hard and horrible. This isn't what Paul is talking about. He's talking about the life of a disciple of Jesus, and that is a struggle. You see, Paul is writing here and he's saying that life is, as a disciple, is a deliberate struggle. It's a struggle that we're looking to have with the world and with our own desires and our own wants and our own selfish nature. That as a disciple of Jesus, we're going to struggle against things that maybe the rest of the world doesn't struggle with. And as a result, they're slipping down and they're not getting to the top. We're choosing to struggle. Paul's analogy in Corinthians of an athlete is helpful. Because, you know, I'm not an athlete myself, but I love sport. I'm reading about sport. And when you read about athletes, you'll know that their life is kind of this constant saying no to their own desires and their own wants. So, you know, whereas most of us might sit down at Christmas and go, right, you know, a week or a couple of weeks of just eating what we want and drinking what we want, whereas we'll be reaching for the extra chocolates and the extra turkey sandwich, an athlete will be going, no, I'm not going to have that. I'm going to struggle against that. I'm not going to have it because I know I've got a race to run. You know, and when maybe it's someone's birthday or there's a party to go out to and we think, great, a night out, I'm going to stay out late. An athlete will be going, no, I'll go, but I'm going to come back early because I've got to train, I've got to struggle. There's a race to be run. An athlete is always saying no to their natural impulses and desires. And that's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9. And Paul says the life of a disciple, if we're going to follow Jesus, is like this. It's about self-control. It's a struggle of self-control. You see, sin has damaged creation so much, and we're part of the creation, so we're part of that. And left to our own devices as humans, we will just kind of do what we want. But left to our own devices, as humans, we will probably just please ourselves. We will make selfish decisions after selfish decisions. The great preacher, Jonathan Edwards, kind of sums it up in this way. And he says, you know, before the fall, before sin entered the world, he describes human beings as being open to everything, open to God, open to other people, open to all that God had for them. But he says, after the fall, we begin to shrink in on ourselves. And Jonathan Edwards says that ultimately, if we just give in to that, if we just allow ourselves to kind of shrink in on ourselves, he says we kind of close up almost to a complete little tiny point, and we shut ourselves off to the exclusion of other people. He writes this, he says, that we'll just be governed and concerned by our own narrow, selfish principles. What sin does to us, he says, and what Paul agrees with, is that kind of we just shrink in on ourselves and we become smaller and smaller and smaller, just concerned with ourselves. Can you hear what he's saying? Our natural lean, left to our own devices because of sin, our natural lean is towards selfishness. But what Paul writes here, when he says, I fought the good fight, when he writes here that he has struggled, he says, we don't have to give in to that. We don't have to become selfish human beings. You see, ultimately, selfishness is at the root of all sin. What I want, we're saying, is more important than what other people want. A disciple of Jesus says, what you want, what others want, is more important than what I want. A disciple of Jesus says, my life for your life, just as Jesus says. And he says, we've got to struggle against that. He says, I've fought the good fight. I have struggled against my natural desires. And if we want to finish well, we've got to choose that struggle too. We've got to say no for that relationship that, even though our body desires it, we know that relationship isn't good for us. We've got to say no to that, to another drink. We've got to say no to pushing ourselves forward and hurting somebody with our words or with our attitudes. We've got to say no to just that desire to always want our own way. We say, my life for your life. We prefer others. If we don't struggle, we'll slip. We'll slip down that road, if you like, and we'll become smaller and smaller and more narrow. And our lives will be all about us. Life, Paul says, is a struggle. It's fighting the good fight against selfishness. But he doesn't, also what Paul says, he says, we don't do that on our own. He says, Jesus sends a helper, the Holy Spirit, who comes and transforms us from the inside out. And the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives is to open ourselves. So we don't just close in ourselves, to open ourselves. He says this, doesn't he, in 2 Corinthians 5. He says, anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. Why are we a new creation? Because we don't have to give in to selfishness anymore. He says, the old is gone, the new has come. We want to finish well like Paul. We too say, I fought the good fight. I have struggled. Second thing that we can learn from this passage, how can we finish well, is that we realise that death is an adventure. Death is an adventure. Paul writes this. He says, I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. The word that Paul uses here about being poured out is like I'm spent. I'm all done. Coming to the end of my life. And there's a sense here that in this second imprisonment in Rome, that Paul knew it was going to end with execution. He says, I'm spent, I'm done. And he says, the time for my departure is near. And when he talks about his departure, he's not talking about departure from prison, he's talking about death. He's talking about the end of his life, the departure from this world. And the word that Paul uses here for departure is the same word that would have been used at that time for untying rope that's attached to a boat that's keeping it moored to the side. So he's kind of saying, you know, I'm ready to be untied. I'm ready to be untied. I'm ready to set sail. I'm ready for a voyage, for an adventure. Can you see Paul's and the Bible's attitude to death here? You know, when a boat leaves a port, when it sets sails, it is sad. You know, you're not going to see people for a while. You're waving goodbye to people. But there is also that sense of excitement when a boat sets sail, isn't there? The sense of an adventure starting. There's potential in that. Something new is about to happen. That's Paul's attitude to death. It's a sense of adventure, of voyage. And we see that in other places in Paul's writings as well. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Paul writes, he talks about death and he talks about people dying and grief. And here he says, I want you to grieve, but he says, don't grieve like those who don't have hope. Don't grieve like the rest of mankind. He says, we've got hope. Grieve, but there's hope. Can you see the balance that he has here with death? Yeah, we grieve and we're sad when we encounter death. But there is hope. He's not asking us to be stoics here and just with no emotion. He's saying, yes, grieve. But for goodness sake, hold on to hope in that grief. And hope in the face of death is so crucial for followers of Jesus if we're going to finish well. A number of years ago now, maybe 15, 16 years ago, I went to a funeral, and it's the only time I've ever been to a humanist funeral. I wonder if you've been to one. And I remember the celebrant who did a good job of leading this funeral. You know, there was no faith in it whatsoever, but they did an all right job until they got to the point where they were talking about life and death. And they pointed to some trees outside of the window at the crematorium. And they said, you see the trees here? And you see the leaves on the tree? And the celebrant said, I find it helpful to think about life as being like a tree and we're all leaves on the tree. And he said, you know, the one thing we can all be certain of is that one day we will fall from the tree. And he was referring to death. And he said, it might be a storm that shakes us from the tree, you know, a sudden thing, or it might be that we slowly wither away. But one thing's for certain, we will all fall from the tree and we will fall to the ground. I thought, ouch, where's the hope? In other words, you know, it's this message of, we're all going to die and there's nothing you can do about it. But there's nothing beyond that. There was no hope. It kind of reminded me of the Disney film, The Lion King. And there's, if you've seen that film, you know, there's that bit where the kind of father lion's talking to the younger lion, Simba. Mufasa, the dad, is talking to Simba. And he says to Simba, one day we will die. And he says to Simba, you know, we're all going to become fertilizer in the ground, essentially. And he says, Simba, you know, we're going to die, we're going to rot, but our bodies will decay and we'll feed the grass. And he says, and the antelopes will eat the grass and they will live. But he says, then our ancestors, other lions, will come and eat the antelopes. And he says, it's the circle of life. And they sing that song, the circle of life, and all that kind of stuff. And it's kind of that attitude, really. And, you know, we watch that film and we sing the song, and maybe you've been to a funeral like the one I've been to, but where's the hope? We're more than fertilizer. We're more than just sort of worm feed. Humans are more than that. You know that. I know that. We're not inconsequential. We're made for more. We're made for eternity. And listen, that's why death hurts so much. That's why it jars when someone we love dies. Because we're not made for death. When God created the world, we read that in Genesis, in the Garden of Eden, we weren't made to die. Death came after the fall. It hurts when someone we know dies. We see this in Jesus, in John chapter 11, when Jesus' friend Lazarus dies. He goes to the tomb, and there's that shortest verse in the Bible, which just tells us that when Lazarus is dead, Jesus wept. Jesus wept. But then after that, we're told he approaches the tomb of Lazarus, and kind of most versions of the Bible put it quite nicely, but if you get the King James Version, which maybe for that version is a little bit more accurate on this passage, it tells us that Jesus goes to the tomb and he groans. He groans. He kind of calls out. You get a sense of the pain that Jesus feels. He's angry at death. But he doesn't despair. And that's what Paul's saying here. He says, don't lose hope in the face of death, because death is an adventure. Jesus raises Lazarus back to life, pointing to what he's going to do for all people who know him, who love him. There is going to be a resurrection. This is the hope that Paul writes about in the face of death. He says, grieve, but hold on to hope. Paul's most famous quote about death is in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And it's like a taunt to death, isn't it? Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? You know, here Paul is saying, come on, death, give me your best shot. You know, you might try and destroy me, but I'm going on an adventure when death finally comes. My life will just only be starting. At that point, I've got all of eternity to enjoy. You might try and destroy me, death, but in Jesus I will live on. When we encounter death, yeah, we should grieve. We should be sad. We should get angry at death. It's not what God ever intended. But we never do that without hope. Finishing well, like Paul finished well, means we hold on to hope. We see death as an adventure. It puts it well in C.S. Lewis's story about Narnia. And in the final book of the Narnia Chronicles, the book The Last Battle, right at the end, when I don't want to spoil this for you if you've never read it, but when all the children have grown up and when they finally died, C.S. Lewis writes this. He says, all their life in this world and all their adventures had only been the cover and the title page. Now at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever and ever, in which every chapter is better than the one before. Isn't that good? Death is an adventure. It's just the start. Finishing well means we see it that way. We're going to speed up. There's two more points. Third point is this. Finishing well, like Paul does, means that the gospel cannot be contained. And here we find ourselves going back to Acts chapter 28. And isn't that the message here? That the gospel carried on even when Paul was in prison, even when faced with death. Why is there such an abrupt ending to the book of Acts? Because it's never about, the story of Acts was never about Paul. And Luke knew that. It's about the advancement and the progress of the gospel. And there's a sense of Luke finishing the book of Acts in this way. And in that, he's saying that, you know, look at all the problems we've read about. Look at all the imprisonment. Look at the opposition. Look at the death of Jesus' followers. And he's saying, you can imprison people. You can kill people. You can put any opposition against people, but you will never stop the progress of the gospel. The gospel cannot be contained. One of my favourite all-time books and films is Jurassic Park. I'm sure you've seen it, the original one from the 1990s. And we're going to watch a clip from that film now. And in this clip, you see Jeff Goldblum, he's one of the stars of that film, he's a scientist, and they're being shown round Jurassic Park, where you know, Richard Attenborough and other scientists have kind of brought dinosaurs back to life. And Ian Malcolm, Jeff Goldblum's character in this clip, is kind of questioning, how safe is this? Really, how safe is this? And one of the scientists in this clip just explains that it's safe because they've only produced female dinosaurs. And here's the dialogue that ensues.
How do you know they're all female? Does somebody go out in the park and pull up the dinosaur skirts?
We control their chromosomes. It's really not that difficult. All vertebrate embryos are inherently female anyway. They just require an extra hormone given at the right developmental stage to make them male. We simply deny them that.
Deny them that?
John, the kind of control you're attempting is... It's not possible. Listen, if there's one thing the history of evolution has taught us, it's that life will not be contained. Life breaks free, it expands to new territories, and it crashes through barriers painfully, maybe even dangerously, but, there it is.
There it is.
You're implying that a group composed entirely of female animals will breed?
No, I'm simply saying that life, finds a way.
Isn't that great? I love that film. I love that clip. But look what is said there. Life will not be contained. Life breaks free. It expands to new territories, crashes through. It's dangerous. And he says this at the end. He says, I'm simply saying that life finds a way. I'm simply saying that life finds a way. If you want to know what the message of the book of Acts is all about, just substitute the word life with the word gospel. This is the message of the book of Acts, is that the gospel will not be contained. The gospel breaks free. It expands to new territories and crashes through barriers painfully, maybe even dangerously. There it is. I'm simply saying that the gospel finds away. Imprison us. Put barriers up against us. Kill us. But the gospel will always find a way. It cannot be contained. An image that's meant a lot to us as a church over recent years is that of the dandelion. And God has spoken to us a lot about that. But one of the things about dandelions, and if you're a gardener, even if you're not a gardener, you'll know this, is that they grow everywhere. You can't stop dandelions from growing. They'll spring up in your lawn. They'll spring up on a pavement. They'll jump up through concrete. Dandelions find a way. I love that image. The gospel always finds a way. It's like these dandelions. They will always take root. The gospel will always root, even under serious persecution. That's why the gospel still grows in countries where persecution is rife. And persecution is rife. 1 in 7 Christians in the world at the moment are persecuted. 5 years ago, it was 1 in 9. 5 years later on, it's 1 in 7. They say that over the last year, there's 5 million more Christians being persecuted than there were 365 days ago. Persecution is rife. It is growing. But Open Doors, who I'm sure you'll know, who support and look after the persecuted church around the world, they write this. They say one of the reasons that it's getting worse and why persecution is on the increase is because the church is growing. In the most hostile of environments, it continues to thrive. The gospel cannot be contained. And finishing well means that we grasp hold of that and then we take every opportunity to share the good news of Jesus with other people. Earlier on in his letter to Timothy, Paul writes this. He talks about sitting in prison and he says, I'm in chains. And then he writes this. He says, but God's word is not chained. Isn't that wonderful? God's word is not chained. To finish well, we need to know this truth as Paul did, that the gospel is the most powerful, the most vital, the most unstoppable force in this world, and it can never be contained. And finally this, finishing well means this, that I know that the one thing I need is friendship with Jesus. The one thing I need is friendship with Jesus. We read this earlier, that Paul writes, at my first defense, no one came to my support. So when he was his first trial, no one came. Everyone, he says, deserted me. May it not be held against them. But look at this, he says, but the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength. Everyone deserted me, Paul writes, but Jesus didn't. And life can be like that, can't it? I'm certain that some of you watching this have experienced that in life, that even your closest friends, even the people you thought would stand by you, as humans, they might sometimes let us down. But Jesus never deserts us. This is a picture of friendship. Now, in Proverbs 18, it says this, there's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. That's a picture of who Jesus is to us. That when everything's against us, when everything is going wrong, Jesus sticks close. This isn't about Jesus' omniscience. This isn't about his omnipresence. This is about his friendship to you and to I. What's he writing here? Paul's saying, I felt Jesus there next to me as a friend. And this is what we need if we're going to finish well, to know Jesus as a friend. This is more than just believing that God must exist. This is more than just being inspired by God or even feeling his presence occasionally. This is knowing Jesus as a friend. Is Jesus your friend? If you want to finish life well, you need to know Jesus as your friend. And you might say, well, okay, Mark, well, how do I get that? How do I know that? How do I get Jesus as a friend? It's the same way that Paul did. It's through the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's how we know Jesus as a friend. It's knowing that Jesus, as the ultimate friend, laid down his life for each one of us. Jesus is the one who on the cross allows everything that's ever been done wrong to be laid upon him. What a friend. He takes that away from us and says, look, I'll take the punishment. I will be in your place. Jesus is the one who on the cross allows himself to be abandoned, allows himself to be friendless, so that you and I can know what real friendship with God is like. Jesus is the one who makes that possible. And this isn't just saying, okay, I believe in God. This isn't just saying, I want to be inspired by God. This is saying, I want to accept that what Jesus did for me is true. It's the greatest act of friendship. And saying to him, come close. Come stand by my side. Come and step into my life. Be my friend. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. Be my friend, Jesus. If we want to finish well, we need to know Jesus as our friend. Incredible, this path that Paul shows us here. Finishing well means that life is a struggle against those selfish desires. It means saying death is an adventure and we grieve, but we grieve with hope. It means understanding that the gospel will never, ever be contained, whatever opposition comes our way. And perhaps most importantly of all, and underlying all of that, it means knowing that Jesus is our friend. Right at the end of 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul's last words really that we read him writing. He's talking to Timothy and to his friend, and he says this. He says, do your best to get here before winter. Do your best to get here before winter. And he's talking as an experienced man of sailing on ships, and he's almost reflecting back here on what we saw in Acts there, that of shipwrecks, and he knows that if they don't get there, if they try and travel through winter on a ship, they're at risk of storms, they're at risk of shipwreck. So really what Paul's saying here to Timothy and to others is he's saying, don't leave it too late. Don't leave it until it's too late. And as we finish, what I want to say to you is this, is that if God is speaking to you, if he's been speaking to you over recent weeks as we've gone through the book of Acts, if he's speaking to you now, especially if he's speaking to you and saying, I want to be your friend, don't leave it until it's too late. Don't leave it until it's too late. Say yes to him today. Ask him into your life. Say, Jesus, I want to know you as my friend. I want to finish well. And know that as you do that, Jesus will come into your life. Let's worship together.
Every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you.
Shall we pray together? And maybe as we're praying, you just want to open your hands as a sign to Jesus that you're open to what you want him to do in your life. And we pray, come Holy Spirit. Come Holy Spirit, fall afresh on us. Thank you for Paul's life. Thank you for this journey over recent weeks as we've travelled through Acts reading about this incredible man's life. Thank you for the example he is of finishing well. And Jesus, I want to finish well. So help me, like Paul, to struggle against my own desires where I need to, empowered by you, Holy Spirit. Help me not to slip. Help me to see death as an adventure, that we don't need to be scared of death. And when we encounter death amongst our friends, amongst our family, help us to grieve, to be angry with death, but to grieve with hope. Jesus, thank you for the power of your gospel, which cannot be contained. Thank you that your gospel always finds a way. Help us to be people of the gospel who look for every opportunity to share the good news. And Jesus, thank you that you're our friend. And for those of us today that have maybe asked you to come close and to be our friend, maybe for the first time, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would fall on those people, that you would empower them to walk with you as your disciple, as followers of the way of Jesus. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us once again for Sunday Online. And as we always say, please do get in touch. If you're feeling God speak to you, if maybe some of what we've looked at through the book of Acts has spoken to you, let us know. We'd just love to hear that encouragement. We'd also love to know how we can be praying for you and supporting you as well. So do get in touch with us. Drop us an email, phone the church. Sally and I love to communicate with you, particularly if maybe you've asked Jesus to be your friend today for the first time. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to send some literature. We'd love to support you on that journey. God bless you. Thank you for tuning in. And we look forward to you tuning in next Sunday for Sunday Online.